Students, last time we had started forces and saw the effect of force on rigid body and non-rigid body. In rigid body, we said that there is no change in shape. That is, there will be no difference in the intermolecular spacing of particles. And then we saw two types of forces. We saw the definition of force, the effect of force, two effects of force, and the two types of forces, contact forces and non-contact forces. We had completed the five contact forces. Now we will see non-contact forces, the three types, in detail and some examples of that, even though we had seen the distinction and vaguely we had even written about it. So non-contact forces, or forces at a distance, are those forces in which there is no physical contact between the force and the object. The forces experienced by body even without being physically touched are called non-contact forces or forces at a distance. Sometimes something very simple like this is asked. You can explain it in your own words. You don't have to mug it up. You can say when there is no contact between the force and the object, such forces are called non-contact forces. And the forces of the experience by that body is called non-contact forces, and you can give the example. But of course, when you write it in your own words, the meaning should not change, and everything that is required in the definition should be there. So it is any force in which there is no direct contact between the force and the object, but still the object experiences a force. Such forces are called non-contact forces. Gravitational force, you all know about it. You throw a coin up, it is going to come down. It won't go away. That is because of the Earth's force of gravity. Now, what is the peculiarity of Earth's force of gravity? Is it a repulsive force? No. It is always an attractive force. It keeps attracting all bodies towards it. So, gravitational force is always an attractive force. The force of attraction between two particles because of their masses is called gravitational force of attraction. So here, this force is a force of attraction only, not repulsion. And we have written the same example that if a ball is thrown up, it will go high to a certain height and then it will fall down. This is because of the force of gravity exerted by the earth on the ball. Next is electrostatic force, which you have learned in standard 8 also. And this, I had given this example earlier also, that if you rub a comb against dry hair, the comb gets charged. And now if you bring the comb immediately to some bits of paper, the bits of paper get oppositely charged. And therefore it gets attracted towards that comb. So like charges repel each other and unlike charges attract each other. Now charge, when you talk about charge, it is positive charge and negative charge. In current electricity, charges are positive and negative. Positive, positive, repel. Negative, negative, repel. Positive, negative, attract. So like charges, they repel, and unlike charges, they attract each other. So your definition of electrostatic forces could be the force, in bracket you can write, of attraction or repulsion, because this is not only attraction, it could be repulsion also, between the charges, positive or negative, is called electrostatic forces. Positive or negative is called electrostatic forces. And that example of the comb is given as the example. Now, magnetic force, we have all done magnetism. What happens in, don't make the mistake, use the right word. In magnetism, you use poles and polarity. The word uses pole and polarity. Whereas in charge, it is positive and negative charges. That is electrostatic forces. Magnetism, don't use the word charge, because we are generally used to positive and negative charge. In magnetism, the word will be two poles. The force of repulsion between two like poles. North-north, repel. South-south, repel. north-south attract. The force of repulsion between two like forces and the force of attraction between two unlike poles of a magnet is called magnetic forces. So force of repulsion between two like poles, magnetic force, so poles, and the force of attraction between two unlike poles of a magnet is called magnetic forces. Iron nails get attracted to a magnet. In this case, iron is just a magnetic substance, but you had learned in magnetism that because of magnetic induction, it gets attracted towards the magnet. So when you bring an iron nail near a magnet, first there will be magnetic induction and then there will be attraction. So we had written a reason also that induction precedes attraction. So first induction occurs, oppositely it gets induced with the opposite polarity and then it gets attracted. So we will go on, and now with that we have only got some factors. We will go to the next frame and see the factors affecting non-contact forces. So in case of non-contact forces, we have two general characteristics. The general characteristics, the first one we have already seen in the previous slide, that is the explanation that gravitational force is always attractive, whereas electrostatic and magnetic forces, they can be attractive or they can be repulsive. So that is one point if you are asked what is general characteristics of non-contact forces. The second point is the magnitude of the force varies inversely as the square of the distance. So if you double the distance, what will happen to the force? First you think force will become less. If you increase the distance, the force will become less. For example, if this is a magnet and I am bringing an iron nail, if it is near, there will be some force. When you move it away, the force will decrease. But now, when you are asked questions based on that, you will have to look at this relation and answer. So what will happen if the distance between the two bodies is doubled? You will not write the force will decrease. Force will decrease, yes. But how much? The force will become 1/4 the original force. That is because 2 whole squared becomes 4. So it will become 1/4 the original force. What will happen if the distance between the two bodies becomes 3 times the original distance? The force will become 3 squared, so it will become 1/9. The force will become 1/9. And similarly, if they ask you what will happen if the distance between the two bodies is halved, that means they were away and now they are brought closer. The distance is halved. Let's say they were 10 centimeters away, now they are brought 5 centimeters away. The force will become 4 times. Half the whole square is 1/4. So 1/4 in the denominator, force will go on top, 4 will go on top. So it will become 4 times. So if the original force was 10 newtons, after the distance is half, it will become 40 newtons. So that is the second point. That is, the magnitude of non-contact forces vary inversely as the square of the distance between the two bodies. Force, magnitude of force, and the distance of separation between the two bodies. Two bodies means one is the, let's say one is the bar magnet which is exerting the force, and the other may be the iron nail which is receiving the force, because of which it is getting induced. Same way it could be between you. It could be between a coin and the earth. When you throw a coin up, the force decreases, but it goes on increasing as it comes down when the distance is decreasing. But for all general things, we take G. G, don't confuse G, small g, with force. Force is measured in Newton. Small g ka value is 9.8 meter per second squared. That is acceleration due to gravity. That is not force of gravity. Anyway, details of that we will be learning in the fourth part, where you see universal law of gravitation. So copy this. I am going to write a little note further that also you can copy before we start with Newton's first law of motion. So this is based on what is explained here, that the distance of separation between two bodies is halved. If it is halved, that means the distance has reduced. Then obviously the force will increase. So it becomes 4 times. But if you don't write this 4 times, you will not get full marks. In fact, you won't get any marks, because when you're told halved, the distance has decreased and become half, so then it becomes 4 times. You have to specify 4 times. Please listen to the explanation and see what I'm specifying. Even in maths, when something is specified and stressed upon, please listen that. Listen to that carefully. So this, again, same thing. Now if the distance between two bodies is doubled, that means you're increasing the distance. So obviously the force will decrease. So when the force decreases, we will have to write specifically, because it is doubled, it becomes 1/4 its original value. The force becomes 1/4 its original value. So copy this down, we will go on to Newton's first law. Now we start with Newton's first law. But before we start with Newton's first law, you should also know one more thing, that Newton's first law is also referred to as law of inertia. Newton's first law of inertia. Because it is based on this new term which you are reading, that is inertia. Inertia is what? It is a tendency of a body which is at rest to remain in rest. And a body which is moving at a constant speed in a certain direction to remain moving in that constant speed and in that certain direction. Now when a body is moving at a constant speed in a certain direction, it is said to undergo uniform motion. So if a body is moving at a uniform speed, it continues to move at a uniform velocity. That is inertia. The simplest example of inertia is, if you are lying down, most of you have difficulty in getting up. It takes some effort to get up. And if you are running, as let's say you are running a 100 meter race, it is very difficult to stop. The moment you run 100 meters, you can't stop immediately. That is because your body is already in motion. So you will move a little more ahead and then gradually slow down and stop. So any body in rest continues to remain in the state of rest. And any body which is moving at a constant speed in a particular direction continues to move in that constant speed in that same direction. That property or tendency, I have underlined the word, that tendency of a body is known as inertia. And inertia depends on the mass. More the mass, more will be the inertia. Simple example is, let's say in the middle of the road there is a truck which is broken down. It will take quite an effort to push that truck and move it to the side of the road. So maybe 7-8 people have to gather, maybe more, and then push it to the side so that the rest of the traffic can move. But at the same time, if instead of the truck it was just a scooter which has broken down, then obviously the man who is riding the scooter will get down and he will push it to the side of the road. It is far easier to push a scooter. That is because the mass of the truck is much more than the mass of the scooter, due to which inertia of the truck is much more than the inertia of the scooter. Very simple example, same thing. If your friend is riding a cycle and coming to you, maybe you will dance in front of him and try to stop him. He's riding a cycle, huh? But if that same friend is coming in a truck in front of you, you wouldn't dance in front of him and try to stop him doing monkey actions. So that won't happen, because obviously the truck, it is more difficult to stop a truck. So even when the brakes are applied, the truck will not come to rest all of a sudden. It takes time, much more time than a car, and the car will take more time than the cycle. The cycle can be brought to rest first, and even you can exert a force and probably halt the cycle from coming. So that is example which states that inertia depends on mass. Sometimes most of the physics questions in the boards are objective questions. They are all one word answers generally, many of them. For example, you could be asked, what does inertia of a body depend on? You don't have to write anything for that. You just have to write depends on the mass of the body. Greater the mass, more is the inertia. That's it. Nothing more you have to write. So that is all about inertia. Now, since Newton's first law is based on inertia, there is just one extra sentence in the definition of inertia in Newton's first law. So we will read Newton's first law. Newton's first law states that if a body is in a state of rest, it will remain in the state of rest. And if it is in the state of motion, it will remain moving in the same direction with the same speed. Till here it's the same definition as inertia. Now the extension or added word which you should not miss if you are asked Newton's first law is unless an external force is applied on it. That is the only extra thing on inertia which is there in Newton's first law. Any body which is in a state of rest continues to remain in the same state of rest. And if a body is moving at a uniform speed, it continues to move at the same speed and in the same direction unless acted upon by an external force is Newton's first law. So you have to mention unless an external force is applied on it. Now that external force has to be an unbalanced force. What do you mean by unbalanced force? Unbalanced force means, now let's say this marker, this scale is at rest. It is at rest. I am pushing it from both sides, but still it's at rest. Why? Because I am exerting equal force with both my hands. Those forces which are in opposite direction and which are equal are called balanced forces. They cancel each other. So the scale is not moving. But if I push it more with this hand, that is the right hand, then the scale will move towards the, in the direction in which the greater push is there. So it is moving that side. This is because now I am exerting a greater force with this hand, that is the right hand. So such a force where one force is more and the other force is less is an unbalanced force. Balanced forces cancel each other. So the external force that is applied or external forces that is applied has to be unbalanced. So you may have, but an example of that is, let's say 8 players on that side, 8 players on this side. You are doing tug of war. So now it is not one force which is acting on that rope. There are 8 and 8, 16 people pulling and pushing the rope. So 8 forces pulling it there and 8 forces pulling it here. So total 16 forces. But if the sum of all these 8 forces on this side and the sum of all those 8 forces on that side is exactly equal, no difference, then the rope won't move and the handkerchief will remain where it is. Doesn't move. It is only when one side exerts a greater force that the rope will move. So that's another example of balanced and unbalanced forces. Balanced forces are equal forces which act in opposite directions, so they cancel each other. And unbalanced forces is when multiple forces are acting on a body, but the net force, that is force is a vector quantity, so after taking direction into consideration, the net force, sum of all the forces acting on that body is not zero. So that is unbalanced force. Anyway, you have to learn the definition of Newton's first law very thoroughly. And in the definition, in addition to inertia explanation, you have to write unless an external force is applied on the body. So that all you copy it down. So we will move ahead with types of inertia. There are two types of inertia. One is inertia of rest and second is inertia of motion. Very simple to understand. If a body is at rest, it continues to remain at rest. That tendency is called inertia of rest. And if a body is moving in a particular direction at a particular speed, then it continues to remain moving in that particular direction in that same speed. That is inertia of motion. So now there are some examples, and you could be asked if you give reasons based on this. In your paper 1, give reason based on this could come. And it is very clearly given in our Anish tutorial textbook with proper explanations. Many examples and many answers are given. So once again, you have to refer to those pages of the chapter 4. Part A and Part B, you should learn all the question and answers from the Anish tutorial book. Most of the answers to most of the questions given in concise, I have given that in our book. So inertia of rest, if a body is at rest, it will remain at rest unless an external force is applied to change the state of rest. That property of the body is called inertia of rest. So if they ask you inertia of rest, don't mention anything about motion, just about rest. So for example, let's say you are standing in a train and the train is at halt and you are just standing. And suddenly when the train moves, you get a jerk in the backward direction. Reason, initially your entire body was in a state of rest because the train was not moving. Now when the train starts moving, the lower body, that is the leg, which is in contact with the train, it also gets pushed in the forward direction. But due to inertia, this tendency to remain at rest, the upper body, that is the head and the torso, all that part, that tends to remain in a state of rest, due to which we get a jerk in the backward direction. That's one simple example of inertia of rest. Another example also which I have given there is when you shake the branch of a tree, a small tree, maybe a chiku tree, or when in the one in which lemon grows. So if you push those branches, some fruits sometimes fall down. The reason is those fruits are weakly attached. Some fruits which fall down, they are weakly attached to the stem or the branch. When you push the branch or the stem, only the branch and the stem begins to move. But those fruits, due to inertia of rest, continues to remain in rest. And if they are weakly attached, they get detached and fall down due to gravity. Now in these answers, I have underlined some words which are key words which you should write. For example, inertia of rest. The entire thing is based on inertia of rest. So that has to be there in the answer. That keyword, inertia of rest, should be there. And what is at rest? The fruits, the upper body, that remains at rest. So that has to be properly explained. There are many more examples. For example, when you keep coins in a carom board one over the other and take the striker and hit the coins, sometimes you see that only the lowest coin, which was on the board, that moves ahead when the striker strikes it. The other coin sometimes just lands down there itself, may not even fall. Sometimes it just falls and scatters there, but the other coins don't move. That is again because of inertia of rest. The entire set of coins were in a state of rest. When the force acted on the lowest coin, that coin moved ahead. But due to inertia of the rest, the other coins went and sat at the same position. Same thing if you have a glass and on top of the glass you place a card, a playing card. And on top of the card you place a coin, a 1 rupee coin. And then you just give the strike to that card. If you hit this card very fast with good force, you will see that the card moves ahead and the coin goes down inside the glass. So that is again because of inertia of rest. The coin was at rest along with the card. When you applied the force on the card, only the card moved ahead, while the coin, due to gravity, it fell down straight into that same glass. So those are all examples of inertia of rest. You take a mat or a carpet, you will find that the maid generally takes a broom and hits it so that all the dust falls down. That is also an example of inertia of rest. Initially, the carpet and all the dust particles were at rest. So when this maid took it up and started hitting it, only the carpet is moving back, whereas all the dust particles which were at rest continue to remain at rest, and because they are weakly attached, they fall down. So the give reason could be asked in different wordings. You just have to ensure that the word inertia of rest is there, and you explain what is at rest and what is moving, due to which it falls down. So this is about inertia of rest. Next we will see some simple examples based on inertia of motion. So now I want to tell you to learn from chapter 3 of Anish Tutorials book, page 55 to page 61, that we would have finished by today in laws of motion. That is part A and part B of the chapter. Part A was force and contact non-contact forces, and part B is this first law of motion and inertia, types of inertia, that is stationary as well as moving body. So now we are looking at inertia of motion. That is the second type of inertia. The definition you can write in your own word: any body which is at rest, which is in motion. A body which is in motion will continue to move in the same state of motion, that is at the same speed and in the same direction, unless it is acted upon by external force. That property or tendency of the body is called inertia of motion. Think of what is written here. A body in a state of motion continues to be in the state of motion with the same speed and in the same direction. They should be there. With the same speed and in the same direction in a straight line, unless an external force acts on the body. So this with the same speed and with the in the same direction in a straight line, a word used for that is uniform motion. Same speed and straight line. In uniform motion, there is no acceleration. Acceleration means change in velocity or change in speed. Velocity includes direction. We have not done chapter 2. So those details will be seen in chapter 2. But this means uniform motion. Unless an external force acts on the body, this property of the body is called inertia of motion. Now, simple examples of this you would have seen. As soon as you stop cycling, pedaling, the cycle doesn't stop. The cycle goes on for some more time. That is because the cycle and you were all in the state of motion. So due to inertia of motion, you continue to remain in motion, and gradually, because of the force of friction, which is a retarding force between the tire and the street or the road, the cycle and you will come to rest, but not suddenly, it comes to rest gradually. Then second example is like, let's say you are in a train and you throw up a marker pen or a ball. Throw up means you are not doing something funny like taking the ball and throwing it outside the train. It is clearly mentioned in the train. If it is thrown up in a moving train, inside only. So you just throw it up, it goes maybe a meter up, and then you will find that the ball comes back to your hand. The reason of that is also inertia of motion. Initially, all the three, that is the train, yourself and the ball, were in a state of motion. You may think that the ball and I were standing only, I was not moving. But all the three were moving, that is relative motion. The trees in the side of the train, they're appearing to go back, no? That is relative motion. So because all of you were in a state of motion, the ball and you have covered the same distance inside the train. So that is why the same distance has been covered in the same direction and in the same time. So that is why that ball falls back in your hand. You just done like this and held it back, it goes up and comes back to your hand. It is not that the ball goes back and falls there. If you've thrown it vertically up, it is mentioned thrown up vertically. That means obviously not like this and like that. It is thrown vertically, straight up. And a little distance. Not that you have thrown it outside the train. Then it will come back to your hand. This is because the train, the ball and the person are in a state of motion. Due to inertia of motion, the ball and the person covers the same distance in the same direction, even after the ball is released. So the ball comes back to the person's hand. Another example, simple example is, if the bus is moving in this direction, and if you are silly, and if it is moving, first of all, from a moving bus or train, no one should jump. But let's say you happen to move out of a moving bus, the bus is moving in this direction, and you look behind and you see your friend and tell hi and get out from the bus which is moving, you will fall on your back. You will go and fall on your back. The reason is, initially the bus was in motion. Your lower feet, lower part of the body, that is the feet, is also in a state of motion. And suddenly when you jump out, the feet comes to rest on the road. But the upper body continues to tend to remain in motion due to inertia of motion, due to which you will fall down. So to avoid that, if at all, due to some emergency, you have to get down from a moving bus, in that case, you have to be careful that you not only get down in the same direction as motion, but as soon as you get down, you should not stop, but you should continue to run in the forward direction, in the same direction, and then gradually stop. The reason is, when your body or your feet, which was in motion, suddenly comes on the ground, it should not stop moving all of a sudden. See, all these answers are given in our Anish tutorial book on pages 55 to 61. So I suggest you learn these two parts very thoroughly first. Next class, we will go ahead and see Newton's second law of motion, which is relatively longer, and there are some examples and sums also based on Newton's second law of motion. Third law is very simple. There will be another 3-4 videos that is required to complete this chapter. So learn this, page 55 to page 61 of Anish tutorial physics textbook. Have a nice, safe stay at home and stay indoors.